This video is to accompany the Cisco Netacad Switching, Routing, and Wireless Essentials course. This video covers Module 7, DHCPv4. In this video, there are three objectives: DHCP concepts, or DHCP4 concepts, configuring a Cisco IOS v4 server, and configuring a DHCP4 client. 7.1, DHCPv4 concepts. Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol v4, or DHCPv4, assigns IPv4 addresses and other network configuration information dynamically. So because of desktop clients typically make up the bulk of network nodes, v4 is extremely useful and time-saving tool for network administrators. And I can tell you, early on in my career in networking and desktop support, we had to take and put IP addresses manually on all of the desktops in the system, and it was time consuming. We also had errors in overlay or duplication of IP addresses, and so when DHCP came along, it was very helpful. So a dedicated DHCP v4 server is scalable. It's relatively easy to manage. However, in a small branch or a SOHO location, a Cisco router can be configured to provide v4 services without the need for a dedicated server. So Cisco IOS software supports an optional, full-featured v4 server. And just so you know, I'm not going to say DHCP v4 server every time. I'm just going to say v4. So the v4 server dynamically assigns or leases a v4 address from a pool of addresses for a limited period of time chosen by the server, or until the client no longer needs the address. So the client leases the information from the server for an administratively defined period of time, and then the administrators configure the v4 servers to set the lease times to time out at different intervals. So the lease is typically anywhere from 24 hours to a week or more in some cases, and when the lease expires, the client must ask for another address, although the client is typically reassigned the same address though. V4 works in a client-server mode. When a client communicates with the V4 server, the server assigns a lease, and the IPv4 assigns a V4 address to that client, an IPv4 address to that client. The client connects to the network with that leased V4 address until the lease expires. Now, the client must contact the DHCP server periodically to extend the lease, and the lease mechanism ensures that the client that moves or powers off does not keep the address that they are no longer needed. So when a lease expires, the DHCP server returns the address to the pool where it can be reallocated as necessary. Now, in the steps to obtain a lease, when the client boots up or otherwise wants to join a network, it begins a four-step process. It sends the DHCP discover. It then does the DHCP offer from the server. So the client request and says, I need an address. So the server then sends an offer back, or DHCP offer. Then they get a DHCP request back again that they accepted the offer. And then the server acknowledges that with the DHCP pack that the V4 address is theirs. So prior to lease expiration though, the client begins a two-step process to renew the lease with the V4 server, as shown in the figure to the right. So you get a DHCP request again. So this is before the lease expires. The client does send a request message directly to the server that originally offered the V4 address. So if the DHCP pack is not received within a specified amount of time, the client then broadcasts another request so that one of the other V4 servers can extend the lease. And then the DHCP acknowledgement comes from the server. So on the receiving request message, the server verifies the lease information by returning a DHCP pack. 7.2, configure a Cisco IOS DHCPv4 server. So now that we have an understanding of how DHCPv4 works and how it can make your job a whole lot easier, not a bit, but a whole lot easier, a Cisco router running Cisco IOS software can be configured to act as a v4 server. So the Cisco IOS DHCPv4 server assigns and manages IPv4 addresses from specified address pools within the router to the v4 clients. So step one, we exclude any v4 addresses that we need. So a single address or a range of addresses can be excluded by specifying the low address and the high address of the range. Excluded addresses should be those addresses that are assigned to routers, servers, printers, and other devices that have been or will be manually configured. So you're going to do all of this in the previous step when you set up your network, you set up your IP arranging, you did all your subnetting, and you figured out which ones are going to have manual IP addresses, which ones are going to be assigned in a DHCP range, and then when we get to this point is when we actually assign them. So you enter the IP DHCP excluded address low, put the address in, and then the high address. And then in step two, we define the V4 pool name, IP DHCP pool-name command, creates a pool with a specified name, and then puts the router in V4 configuration mode. And that's identified by the prompt router DHCP-config. And then on step three, we configure the V4 pool. The address pool and default gateway must be configured. You use the network statement to define the range of available addresses, and then we'll use the default router command to define the default gateway router. And the commands below and other optional commands are shown in the table. You can define the address pool using the network command, define the default router or gateway with the default router command. You can define the DNS server. You can define the domain name. You can define the duration of the lease, and then you can define the NetBIOS WAN server. And on this slide, we have a configuration example. We set IP DHCP excluded address range. We set the range there. Then we set our name. We set the network, the default router, the DNS server, and the domain name. And then we back out. We can use the commands below to verify that the V4 server is operational. We can do the show run config, section DHCP. We can do the show IP DHCP binding. That displays a list of all V4 addresses to MAC address bindings. And then we can do the show IP DHCP server stats. That displays account information regarding the number of V4 messages that have been sent and received. And this is an example of the commands that we can do, the show run config. And then we get this information. Here's where we can verify the DHCP V4 bindings with the show IP DHCP binding. And then we can verify the statistics. We do the show IP DHCP server statistics, and this is used to verify that messages are being received or sent by the router. On the client side, we can do the IP config slash all command, or if you're on Linux, you can use the if config. And then when issued on PC1, it displays the TCP/IP parameters shown in the example here to the right. So you'll get your Ethernet information, you'll get your V4 address information, your subnet, when your lease was obtained, when it's going to expire, your default gateway, and your DNS servers. We can also disable the Cisco IOS V4 server. We do the no service DHCP global config mode command, and then use the service DHCP global. So we set no service DHCP and then service DHCP. So enabling the service has no effect if the parameters are not configured. And there's a note here that clearing the DHCP bindings or stopping and restarting the server may result in duplicate IP addressing being temporarily assigned on the network. In a complex network, enterprise servers are usually located centrally, and these servers may provide DHCP, DNS, TFTP, and FTP services from the network. So network clients are not typically on the same subnet as those servers. So to get that server information or to get those services, clients often use broadcast messages. And in the figure below, PC1 is attempting to acquire a V4 address from a V4 server using a broadcast message. So in this scenario, R1 is not configured as a V4 server and does not forward the broadcast. So because the V4 server is located on a different network, PC1 cannot receive an IP address using DHCP. R1 must be configured to relay the V4 messages to the V4 server. So we're going to configure R1 with the IP helper address command and then with the address in there. And that configuration command will cause the R1 to relay V4 broadcast to the V4 server, as shown in the example below. And then when R1 has been configured as a V4 relay agent, it accepts broadcast request for the V4 service and then forwards those requests as a unicast to the V4 address 192.168.11.6. And then the network administrator can use the show IP interface command to verify the configuration. the V4, DHCPv4 is not the only service that the router can be configured to relay. So by default, the IP helper address command forwards the following 8 UDP services: port 37 for time, port 49 for TACACS, 53 for DNS, 67 and 68 for DHCP, 69 for TFTP, nice, port 137 for NetBIOS, and 138 for NetBIOS datagram service. 7.3, configure a DHCP V4 client. There are scenarios where you might have an access to a DHCP server through your ISP. In these cases, you want to configure a Cisco IOS router as a V4 client. So sometimes Cisco routers in a small office, SOHO, and branch sites have to be configured as DHCP V4 clients in a similar manner to client computers. So the method used depends on the ISP. So in its simplest configuration, the Ethernet interface is used to connect to a cable or a DSL modem. So to configure an Ethernet interface as DHCP client, use the IP address DHCP interface configuration mode. And in the figure below, you want to assume that the ISP has been configured to provide select customers with an IP address range, or from this number here, 209.165.201/27. So the network range after the GZ001 interface is configured with the IP address DHCP command. And this is the example we would use here. So you configure the Ethernet interface as a DHCP client. We do IP address DHCP, make sure that it's up. And then we can do the show IP interface to make sure that it is configured properly. On a Cisco home router, they're typically already set to receive V4 addressing information. So below we can also go though, and we can look for the automatic configuration DHCP, or you can set it to be manual and set up a DHCP server on a home router as well. So what did we learn in this module? You can pause the video at this point if you want to review these. This is slide 1, and this is slide 2.